I ask you, Lord, this morning to bless the church in a special way. That you've promised to anoint us and to empower us to do the work that you've called us to do on this earth. And so we stand that promise today too. And we also stand the promise that you say where two or three are gathered in your name, you're there. And so your spirit will be poured out. And I pray, Lord, that this morning, standing on your promise through the name of your Son, Jesus, that our hearts will feel your presence and our ears and our hearts and minds will hear your voice this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, we thank you, Lord. Open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 28, and we're going to leave it there, and then we're going to introduce our year time together. I don't know about you, but we started the year, I think, in the right note, the way that we needed to start the year. Thank you for bringing that water. By the way, I'm going to be drinking more water than ever before. Sipping a little bit more. I saw the doctor this week, and I'm taking some meds, and he's checking me back on 2 months. He's going to check me back, but I have some kind of ulcer, a small ulcer on my vocal cord, and that comes from, I guess, gastric juices, the juice of the stomach, when you go to sleep, and if you eat too late, which has been my custom lately, that some of the juices slip back through the throat from your stomach to the throat, and they've been burning my vocal cords. And so I got a little thing there. He said it's minor, but I'm glad that I went to check with him, and I didn't pay attention to my regular physician, who I mentioned it to him. He didn't care. I said, well, you know what? I'm going to go to the specialist. And so we went, and he checked it out. He poked my nose and everything through the back. And I even saw it. It was kind of a painful but incredible to see that inside. Not that you need to be grossed out this morning, but it was interesting. But he did say it, so we'll take care of that. So keep in your prayers, and we'll follow the treatment, and by God's grace, within 2 months, I'll be back to normal. So if you hear my voice a little deeper than ever before, it's due to that. But so today, we're going to get through this anyway. So Matthew 28, and before we get to the Word of God this morning, I just want to point out to you some of the blessings. Maybe we count together the blessings of this 2011 that just went by, because I don't know about you, but I'm very thankful of the way that God has been moving among us. Can you say amen? I know that not everybody's satisfied. I know that, you know, that not everybody got what they wanted, you know, in 2011, right? None of us do. But I think if we look around as a church community, we have evidences among the people sitting next to you, the newer, especially the newer faces that are here. Can you say amen? Amen. Hello. Amen. And those that have been here forever, I think I could see in those faces, to those who've been here the longest, I've seen God moving in our midst in 2011, blessing us in a special way through many different channels, through many different people, and in many different ways. Can you say amen?
Amen.
I mean, just to give you a small example, just today, this week, we have brand new reception resource desk center as you come in. Can you say amen to God?
Amen.
Praise the Lord for that. Wasn't that beautiful when you walk in? I hope it impressed you as it impressed me.
Amen.
And I'm not being biased, but there was Sister Heron, who was part of the design too, and the whole idea. I have to give credit to her because she was part of it. And we went to the right person, and we were looking for something out there to bring to the person that we're walking an environment, an idea that we want to be of help to you. We welcome you here, and let us help you in any way we can. That's what that desk, reception resource desk, means. Can you say that?
Yeah.
It's not trying to be fancy. It's not trying to forget always. It's for us to begin to be effective to anyone that walks through those doors, to let them know that we really are interested in them being here, and we really want to be helpful to them. Can you say that?
Yeah.
And you might not think it's important, but let me tell you, it's better than the wall that we had there last year. When we started the year last year, there was a wall. As you walk into the Lord, there was a wall that hit you right when you came in. Didn't it? Yes, it was. It was the mother's room. It was nice. It was used. But to me, when he walked in, it kind of just hit me with a wall. And some of you came in as new members, you recognize that. Now, maybe not you who were here for the longest time, because you got used to that wall, right? And you got used to the things, so to you it didn't mean anything. But to the newer comer, who those who are not here yet, when you walk in, now I praise the Lord. Now this not giving credit to anybody, but only to Jesus Christ. You said that? That thanks to Christ and to the work and the dedication of many people and your dedication and your openness to change. Somebody asked me, asked the year was finished, and they came to check us out to visit the church, and they noticed a lot of changes. And so the person who visited, was a member of this church a while back, and came back here and checked it out, and that person called me back and said, you know, Alex, I just wanted to know, how are you really doing in that church? How are you doing? And I don't know why, he just got concerned and he wanted to check with me to see if I was okay. And I said, hey, listen, man, I'm blessed. I think God has blessed us in many different ways. And so his question was, how do people deal with change? Because I know the people there, he said. I know some of the old timers, I know some of the people there. And so he said, how do people deal with change? And I said, well, I'll be honest with you. When I see people, and even those who are struggling through change, who are journeying through change, they are open to God's leading. And if you know that your desire and your purpose is to serve God, even though the change might be uncomfortable for them, they're journeying through it, and they're open to God to shed light and to bless us as we move forward through it. But that's, so I see an attitude of openness, I tell this person. I said, you know, I really see God blessing us and leading us and the people being open. Yes, it might not be, things might not be as they were done all these years, and things are changing, but they are opening their hearts to the possibility that God wants to do something different among us and bless the community and bless each other. And so, I guess, I don't know if that was the answer he was looking for, but that was exactly what I saw and what I've seen this last year and a half together. It's unbelievable, but now we're going into our more than a year and a half. This July will be our second year. We'll officially serve you and we'll be journeying with you for 2 years this coming July. So it's been over a year and a half. And some of you are thinking, it can't happen. I just thought you just came in like last week, right? But yeah, it's been over a year and a half. And what a blessing. And so I'm just pointing that out to you to let you know. And there are many other reasons, many other ways that you see God blessing and leading. The fact that now we are getting ready to really do small group ministries and open ourselves up to what God will do as we open our homes to study of the Word of God, to reaching out to our neighbors and inviting them to come to our homes, and opening the Word of God and sharing with those that we live in community with. That we even open to that is a blessing and a potential for what's going to happen in 2012. But as we begin the year, I want to make sure that we all start on the same page. And so those of you who are coming back and are frequent guests, we are so glad that you're here. We want to share this message with you too, and with especially the church family. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 and 19 on. We're going to do 18, 28. And this is where we're going to start this year, where the New Testament church started over 2,000 years ago. Because this is the inaugural words of God establishing his church. This is how God begins his church. Okay? Officially, he says, Of course, after his resurrection, Jesus comes to the disciples. And listen, then Jesus came and spoke to them. But you know, let me read verse 17, because I meant to read verse 17, because this is very interesting, and now I want it, it's true. And when they saw him, verse 17 of chapter 28, they worshiped him. But some doubt. Now, mind you, they see Jesus, this is the Son of God, who's just finished sacrificing, opening the word, the way for the world to be saved, and he's ready to give them the commission speech, right? He's going to tell them what the mission is, he's going to tell them what church is all about. And this is a group of believers, but Matthew points out that among them, hello, there were still some who doubted. So it's okay if not everybody is on the same page. It's okay if there are some among us that might be hesitant about what God's going to do in 2012. Are you saying amen? Because it's not really up to the group, it's up to what God will do and how he's going to manifest himself. And it's up to those who will be open enough to allow God to fill their lives and for him to flow through us. So those that they may doubt, it's okay, go ahead and doubt. Because the church will be established, the church will be blessed, and God will do his work among the hearts of those who will be open to him. Can you say amen? And this is very, very important to understand. That God knows our condition, and Matthew points it out, that not everybody will be in the same page, but he says, and this is what Jesus will tell the church, and this is what he tells us today. And again, we begin 2,000 years ago where the church started. He says to them, Jesus came and spoke to them and said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And we covered this verse many times before. You heard many people preach on it. But then Jesus says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end. So we begin by understanding, friends, that this is what the leadership of the church, and those of you who chose to be part of this process, this journey last year, we came to agree that the mission of the church has not changed. Can you say amen? We are still about making disciples, right? Jesus says that the mission of the church, and he gives his church a mission, he says, go therefore and make disciples. And we've covered this. We covered about this, the fact that it's a going, it's an action verb. It's not just stay at church and wait for people to come to you. And we covered this last year. We mentioned that the best potential for evangelism happens when you go back to work on Monday. Can you say amen? That is when evangelism needs to take place. Not only in the weekends here, when we bring people to church, which we will grow and the Lord will bless, but you understanding that your command, your mission is to go. That whatever you are, that's where God is sending you to make disciples. And the disciple making process is not for us, it's not up to a church only to do. It's true. This year we've been established, we've been put in place kind of a discipleship track, what's called a life development process for our church. We find different steps. We're talking to the leaders about this, to the elders, and we bring them to the board as we move through the year. But discipleship doesn't really happen just in a church context, in this context, week and weekends. No. Discipleship, the Lord says, go and make disciples, because to make disciples, you need to go, and you're the one who's making disciples. In other words, it's not the pastor and the leaders making the disciples only. It's your job to make disciples. So you go and you're making disciples, because discipleship is the process of life. You go and you share. And you get in bed, you know, you get in a situation with people where they are in the struggle, and then you make disciples. You teach them how to react, how the Word of God will teach them how to react. You will teach to them the details of how to serve God and how to allow the Lord Jesus Christ to become Lord of their lives too, just as your life is led by the Lord Jesus Christ.